take on the best of this moment. So everybody has to work in a team and everybody has to respect each one of us. Isn't it?
Yes.
And after the session, I will take the feedback and then we will have an interaction with them. Okay, I think we have some people from Becca ma'am. I don't know the name of it. Welcome to all of you for this wonderful session.
I worked with last night to Prof for 2 years and then I went to IIM Bangalore. I post graduated in both operations and finance. So IIM does not have, you know, kind of a specialization, we just do electives the way you like in whichever format. And I chose operations and finance. I joined ICICI, which is the old financial institution in my bank. Basically in the digital commercial appraisal of projects. I worked on a lot of investment opportunities. I worked on a lot of turnaround cases within ICICI. And then I started a consulting division within ICICI, essentially to make manufacturing engineering companies funded by ICICI globally competitive. So we will touch upon that scenario because that was the time of 1991. You know what happened in 1991. Okay. So in our course of time, we will talk a bit about that particular period and how the whole transformation of financial systems started. So that was the time which I was fortunate or unfortunate to be part of. And so we started this consulting division and I was part of this. Then I have been on my own doing some kind of teaching also. Then I have been CEO of a Kalyani company. I have a managing director of other companies. I am an independent operating partner for a private equity fund. I am sort of an operating partner for a couple of engineering companies, advisory board of them. And that's how my life goes. So, just a short bit of that. So, what we will be touching Sanjay Jain, we will be introducing him. He's also my favorite alumni from my mentor. And basically, we will cover the 6 topics in some format today, which I will talk about as soon as Sanjay introduces.
Why is there an institution which is there and what kind of role it performs
that, let's say, you know, as you can understand, the financial market everywhere, not only in India, is changing so drastically. You know, I mean, every 6 months there are new crises that every institution has to grapple with. Based on that experience, I have interacted with all of this. So kind of understand what's going to happen and all that. So I have my own views on that, which I'm going to share as part of this course. So that's where we'll probably start.
So just a profile from your side, so that we understand more. We are talking to how many people from the distance learning batch and how many from just for the distance learning batch.
First of all, distance learning.
Okay. How many people with commerce background?
Everybody.
How many people with some experience? So what exactly does the financial management, what does it do? I don't, this is not about advanced financial management. We'll come to that. Just basic financial management.
Only
There is nothing like an absolute thing. Because we are talking about future, remember that. Okay? Whose future and who sees the future? Nobody. Okay? This is a very, very important concept, because everything that you will see in the financial management, whether advanced, international, or whatever one talks about, is extremely revolving around the concept of value. Okay? And that value is different from everybody's point of view, different from where they stand, different from how they see the world, different from how they evaluate the risk, not in terms of how they prepare the Excel spreadsheet. Okay? This is extremely important. Okay? So, that it is about future, the value is about future. And the future, nobody knows. Okay? If we had a crystal ball, let's say, then the shares will not get traded. Simple. Okay? And the shares will be absolutely at the right value of the company. But simply because we don't have crystal ball and everybody is making his own value judgment, okay? That is why this difference arises. And now what the financial management is trying to do is to make sure that from the investor's point of view, okay, or from the company's point of view, which are actually two different things, the value of its business or the shares can be improved through proper management of funds. Okay? Management of funds meaning flow of funds. Funds remaining static has no value. Okay? Funds have to be raised, funds have to be used. Okay? How you raise the funds and how you make a judicious allocation of those resources, okay, in order to optimize your value. Now, whether that value is tomorrow, day after tomorrow, 1 year, 5 years down the line, is once again to be seen from the investor's point of view. Okay? The company might say that I am going to only spend in R&D this year. Okay? In order to reap benefits 3-4 years down the line. Okay? Doesn't mean that it is destroying the value. Similarly, another company might say that, okay, forget about R&D, I am going to just splurge on the advertising. Okay? It is that company's choice of how it wants to drive the value. The company might want to do it in a particular fashion. The investors might look at it in a different fashion. And investor B might completely look at it in a different fashion. And that is why all these transactions take place. Otherwise, the transactions would never take place. So this is a very, very, very important concept that I think we should be talking about. So it is always a greater pull theory. Okay? If I am trying to sell something and somebody is wanting to buy from me, obviously from my point of view he is a greater pull. And from his point of view I am a greater pull. Okay? So this is important. Second thing, I think a very important concept that one must talk about is about the risk and the return. Okay. Do we realize what is the risk?
Uncertainty.
Okay. Uncertainty meaning, does it mean that there are no returns?
Higher the risk, higher the profit.
Profit, okay, let's talk about returns, because profit, as I said, is a notional thing. So higher the risk, higher the returns. Or is it higher the return, higher the risk?
Higher the risk.
Okay. So this is very, very important to understand. Okay? And why that is the case? Why that is the case? So suppose we were to draw a graph, okay, with risk on the x-axis and return on the y-axis. The graph would essentially look like a what does it mean? No, I can understand what your fingers like this, but I cannot understand what you're trying to do. So, unless you're asking me to sit up. So, it would be like a straight line with a 45 degrees, because the more you further have risk, the further returns you should be expecting. That is important. Now, why that should be the case? Simple thing. It should make common sense, but still it is important to just understand why should that be the case that higher the risk, higher the return. Suppose lower the risk, higher the returns. There is a case when there is a low risk and a high return. Then what happens? High return. Good business.
There will be more investors.
Yeah.
There will be more investors.
More investors coming. Absolutely. Okay. So there will be more competition. Okay. They will drive down the returns. Okay. And obviously, if it is the other way around, that there is a higher risk and a low return, then there will be people who would be exiting out of that and make sure that somehow the risk-return balance gets restored. Okay. Now, is it? Can we not find the businesses where there is a low risk and high return? Chair level, or is it something that is interesting, something the way we should be going about, or we should be going to some higher level, some chair level. competition. There is no competition. So obviously the entry barriers are not there, and there is an unrestricted competition. Okay, anybody can come in, anybody can compete. Okay, and there is a basically free for all. Okay, what French would call a laissez-faire in the market, that essentially is the free market. Okay, what is the rational market? What is a rational market? We just discussed it. So rational market would mean that everybody is deciding objectively. Okay, I am not taking irrational decisions. Okay, I am not, for example, suppose I don't like, let us say, stocks of, let's say liquor company, you bet. Okay. On moral grounds, on ethical grounds, okay, that does not prevent me, okay, from investing in the stocks. If the stock is good, okay, I will do it. Okay, so rational competition will mean I am taking an objective economic decision, okay, irrespective of ethical, moral, or whatever this thing, as far as it is allowed within the law, obviously, okay, but I am doing everything which is rational. Okay, what is a perfect market?
Many buyers, many sellers.
Yeah, but many buyers, many sellers. What? So it is not just the many buyers and many sellers. Let us be very clear. Okay? But perfect market means everybody has all the information. Okay? This is extremely important because we discussed that the value is about future, right? Now, how can I think about future if I do not have the information right? Okay? If I do not have the information, for example, that the company is going to get, let us say, some very large export contract, which is extremely profitable, or some molecule of a pharmaceutical company has actually passed clinical trial. This information is not available to me, and information is available only to the people within the company or few people, they will make profit on this. Okay? So the perfect market means that everybody must have all the information. And despite that, you can have a market simply because even if I have all the information in the world, okay, it doesn't mean that I look at it the same way that is very, very, very important. Okay? So perfect market means everybody must have exactly the same information all the time. Now, what is an efficient market? These are all simple words, okay? But these are extremely important concepts when we are talking about anything in financial market. So just the basics. So, efficient market is somewhat related to the perfect market, but not the same thing. Perfect market means, as I said, everybody has all the information. Okay? Whereas in the efficient market, what it means is that the price of anything, any security or a commodity or whatever it is, reflects all the available information. It reflects, it captures all the available information. Okay? These are two different things. One is to have the information. Second is to make sure that that information gets reflected in the value. Okay? So are the markets efficient? Are the markets perfect? Whether even markets are free? Okay? Obviously these are not, these are utopian ideas. Okay? But from where we started to where the world is going, obviously it is more towards free market, more towards more perfect market, more towards more. That is very, very important. So, but this is extremely important things about the market that I have.
take up and we still want to understand some of the details as well. So what I had thought is that from the books, we still have to talk about the books a bit or overall topics which are covered in the books. And then as we go on, if there are, I was assuming that at least there will be some questions and then we'll talk about those topics in detail. But as we go on, wherever I think there are new developments or there are something more that we need to understand, I'll get into those details and then we'll probably take it that way. Okay, so the first topic that we will talk about, as Bhushan said, the first one we will talk about the capital market players. You know, what kind of entities are there? What kind of functions do they have? What basic functions do they carry in the system, in the overall financial system? What tools do they use? What tools or instruments do they use? Do they use to carry out their functions? This is what we will focus in the first half. In the second half, we'll get into a little more detail where we'll talk about some of the financial analysis topics, some of the advanced financial management topics, and taxes. So when we talk about usually do not give so much of time to get answers. But capital market is something, it's a financial system where any company can actually go to raise long-term finances. So that's essentially, simplistically, the definition of capital market, that it's a market for accessing medium-term, it's accessing funds in the medium-term, for medium-term and long-term uses. Now, of course, when you talk about the financing process, then you also have to talk about what kind of tools which are used to get those finances. So what kind of tools do we see in the capital market? Sorry? Okay. So essentially we use securities as a broad term. We use securities to raise finances from the capital market. Now, the categories of securities are? The categories of securities are equities or debt or any kind of hybrid instruments. Now, within the equity class itself, there will be preference shares or common shares and so on. So, within each, similarly on the debt side also, when we use debt as an instrument to raise capital, there will be several categories of debt instruments. So as we go on, we'll talk about that. And capital market is used by both the government as well as any private limited company or public limited companies to raise long-term or medium-term funds. So that's a definition of capital market. Now I think as Bhushan was saying, so essentially capital market is being used as an engine of growth because when you talk about raising capital, there are three or four ways that you can raise capital, you know, as a company or as a government. So from a simplistic perspective, as a company, you can raise capital from your own savings. You can raise capital from some of your friends and families. You can also raise capital, let's say, from some of the people that you know. Or you can raise capital from a larger institution, or you can raise capital from the overall public, or people who are there in the system, and through a structured mechanism. So capital market includes all of this. So we'll talk one by one about each one of those aspects. You know, so like some of those when I talked about the fact that you can also raise capital from some of the larger institutions, it's called venture capital or angel investor networks are there. So those are institutions that we'll also talk about.
So obviously capital market enables the flow of funds from somebody who has surplus or excess of funds to somebody who requires or in need of those funds. So that is why unless capital market is there, there will be no growth avenues which is available to somebody. You know, you can always, by taking money from your own pocket when you want to grow or when you want to set up a company, you can only go so far. And that is why capital market is extremely important for any economy, in India or any other economy. So that's why it's called the engine of growth. And because it provides that kind of access to people to raise capital and human beings, by nature, obviously, every time you think about what are the workarounds or what are the shortcuts and risk return, everybody thinks that I want to take less risk and make more return. So obviously, you have to regulate those markets also, because as we know, unless you structure that process, the capital market process, when a company is raising capital, there are some other people who might have better information about the company, and because of that, they might take advantage of that information. So that's why there is a need for regulating this capital market also. Okay. So essentially, there are different groups of institutions. So when you talk about somebody actually giving funds for the growth purposes to the company also, usually we keep our money in the banks. I mean, if we have less amount of money, we'll keep it with ourselves. But if we have more amount of money, then we'll have to keep it in the banks. And banks also have different functionalities. But then, what are the typical categories of banks that we see in the market? So banks are also one of the important parts of the overall capital market in terms of enabling the system. So what kind of banks what categories of banks do we have? Do we usually see in our country or anywhere else? So we see, so if we go through it again, so we see private banks, we see public sector banks, PSBs versus PSBs, public sector banks, private sector banks, and cooperative banks. Sorry? LICs. So there are again categories of banks where we say that we have private sector banks and public sector banks. So those are called commercial banks as a category, because their primary purpose is to actually take money and then lend that money and in the process make some amount of spread on that. So and then we have cooperative banks which have a different purpose as far as their setup is concerned. So we'll also talk about how what kind of cooperative banks are there. Why do they exist in the system? Then there are banks like somebody talked about this. The banks which are specifically meant to lend credit or give money to the agricultural or rural development sectors. So there are specific banks set up for that. Again, on the top of those banks, we have some regulator which is called the RBI, the Reserve Bank of India. So again, as we also know, to lend to the agricultural and rural areas, obviously there is huge, there is more risk in terms of lending to those sectors as compared to lending to normal companies, which the commercial banks do. So on the top of those banks, then there are some other banks who refinance those banks. Meaning they actually guarantee some portion of that loan which goes out of this banks to the agricultural and rural sector. So there are something called development financial institutions, banks like NABARD or IFCI and all that, so which we will also talk about. And then of course there are again we are actually talking a little bit mixed up between capital markets and financial markets. So capital markets, when I said we talked about this market where a company or a government can go to raise medium-term and long-term funds. So that's what the capital market, and there are institutions we talked about. When we are talking about these banks now, we are probably talking a little more about the financial market system, you know, what are the entities. Even to bring some amount of money to the capital market so that it has to be stored somewhere else, it has to be saved somewhere else. So that's a larger financial market system. So financial market also includes institutions like all these insurance institutions, you know. I mean, any kind of life insurance, non-life insurance companies, LICs, all of those institutions. Okay. So how do we again reserve bank? I mean, probably we'll talk about that later. We'll get into the details later. So in what way do we know, and what instruments do we use to save money in the banks? So let's talk about some of the instruments also. You know, and what are the differences? Right. What's the difference between FD and RD? So, if I can give you a pointer as to, you know, usually all these instruments that that we use to save money in the banks, they are differentiated in terms of two parameters. One is, how do you actually give the money to the bank, in the bank? How do you deposit and how do you take out? So from that perspective, tell me, what's the difference between FD and RD? Instruments. You know, there are differences, but they are applicable to both the instruments. But what I am saying is, how do you deposit some money and how do you take out that money? So, I mean, this is how usually the instruments are defined by any bank. So, FD is always that, you know, it's either you can do, you know, it's always some amount of lump sum amount you deposit right now. At some point in the future, you get some lump sum amount. Recurring is always you make the payment in some installments, and at some point in time, you get a lump sum payment. So that's a basic difference. And of course, there are interest rates and all that jazz which goes along with that. What's the difference between savings and a current deposit? Current account or current deposit? Yes.
Saving account, the number of transactions are less than the current account.
See, again, when I'm listening to this answer, see, when we say that we have gone through a finance management topic, we have to go beyond a general user. You know, I mean, whatever answers I'm, so this is probably why you guys have to go through the books, because that's otherwise we are probably just talking like a user. You know, otherwise I haven't gone through the topic. So, but still, those answers we need to understand the fundamental points. You know, I mean, why. What's the basic difference between a current account and a savings account? Let's say.
Savings is used for the saving purpose and that makes a user of it. And current is a used for the business purpose. Okay. Right. Current account also have a usual current account. But basically, one is for the purpose of business and saving is the purpose of saving.
Yes. So that's, so yeah. So you need to understand the purpose of the. Savings account, you actually use that amount of money which you do not probably need for some amount of time. But current account, it's like every day, the next moment itself, you can actually withdraw. So that's there is a purpose, difference in purpose as far as those two accounts are concerned. Okay. Now let's also talk a little bit about development finance, the DFIs, you know, as we call it, the development financial institutions, NABARD. So has anybody worked, you know, has some idea about NABARD, what happens? Why do these development financial institutions exist? Okay. So there are obviously we'll talk a little more on this. So NABARD is obviously pretty well known as far as the DFI is concerned. So the objective of NABARD is to set up specific funds along with other commercial banks from which credit can be given to the agricultural or rural sector. So why that is required is, as I said, the risk of getting those loans, the risk usually is higher when you extend credit to those kind of, you know, people who have lesser predictability in terms of making the repayments. So that's why you need some amount of support from the bank, from another bank, you know, which can take that risk so that those loans can be extended. So NABARD is for the purpose of agriculture and rural development. And there are other banks like industrial. So NABARD is for agriculture and rural development. There are other banks like IFCI, which is for industrial activities. So let's say the government also comes up with several schemes where it actually wants to encourage industries which have between 1 and 10 kind of people. So those kind of people, you know, on all these small scale industries, SSIs or MSMEs that we call. So they also keep coming up with all of these schemes. So they have to route those schemes through one of the institutions. So that's one of that is called IFCI, Industrial Financial Corporation of India. So you can see the difference is to which the difference lies in to which sector they are addressing to. So IFCI is another one. The third one is about SIDBI, Small Industrial Development Bank of India. So SIDBI is also another institution. Again, so they initially it was set up to extend loans into SSIs and MSMEs. But over a period of time, based on the focus that the country has right now on startups, so all the schemes that the government wants to run for startups now is getting routed through SIDBI. So SIDBI is actually setting up funds. It's getting grants, some amount of grant. Like I don't know if you guys would have heard in the last budget. So the government is routing around 10,000 crores over a period of 5 years, which is being routed by through SIDBI. Now SIDBI is going to contribute some amount of that money to the venture capital funds. The venture cap around 20% of that fund, and the venture capital fund is going to bring another 80%. And then, so essentially, what happens is this 20% also goes from SIDBI to those venture capital funds as grants. So that's what allows a private player to take that risk of extending this credit to somebody else. So that's essentially the benefit of any DFI. You know, as a DFI, I put 20%, and the other guy actually brings in another 80%. But at least the guy thinks that hey, 20% I have got it as grant. So even if I have some amount of cushion that I can play with. There are other ones like Exim Bank, Export Import Bank also, which essentially again for those institutions who are involved in export and import of products and services to the country. So that's typically what the financial institutions that we are talking about. Obviously, there are different kind of variations about that. They have evolved quite a lot also in terms of what sectors they are addressing over a period of time. So we'll go through that a little bit in detail. So does anybody have any question on that in terms of financial market entities? Entities or their functions, or if somebody thinks that there is something that we also have not covered. Is there any other entity that you can think of, let's say when you look around in the financial market in the country? And so we'll talk about that as we go up. Now, One important, so let's, so both this financial and capital markets, as we can, as we understand, whenever there are players, and those players have some specific objectives to attend. Let's say if it's a development financial institution, its objective is to actually extend credit. You know, its objective is not to maximize profits as compared to, let's say commercial bank, you know, I mean, which is publicly listed. So unless it comes up with quarter and quarter profit growth, it's going to be tanked in the stock market. So there is a difference in objective because of which all these institutions exist. And sometimes those objectives are in contradiction to each other. So when we have a group of people operating in a market and with different set of objectives, so how do we ensure that the market functions efficiently or in an optimized way? How do we ensure that? When there are, let's say you can, when it's a cricket match, there is one team which is all out to bowl out the opposition at minimum score, and the other side is there to score as many runs as possible. So how do we coordinate that, and how do we build the rules, and who is responsible for the for maintaining those rules or ensuring that the rules are maintained?
The umpire.
So that's why any institution, as I said, any ecosystem where all of these players are there, so we need an umpire. So we need somebody who essentially has to function in two capacities. One is that he actually frames the rules. He says that, hey, this is how you are going to work. This is how you are going to work. And then whenever there are conflicts or complexities around arising out of these interactions now that they have started, so he will resolve those conflict situations, right? So similarly, in the capital market also, so there is an umpire, or there is somebody who we call the regulator, and that's so securities and exchange board of India. Now what? I also talked about it. So what's the basic objective of SEBI? Regulates the function of SEBI is Section 11. So, as part of that Act, 1992 Act, so which says that they have to they have to define the define the functionalities of each of the intermediaries in the system, in the capital markets. So what kind of intermediaries are we talking about in the capital market? Let's say when we are talking about capital market, what intermediaries are we talking about? And before that, essentially, where does this capital market activities happen? Where do they take place? Let's say in our current environment. So it happens in an exchange.
So NSE and BSE are
stock exchanges. So it happens in a stock exchange. And these are called recognized stock exchanges, RSEs, for forming these RSEs, SEBI has the primary responsibility of approving this recognized stock exchanges. So as of now, how many stock exchanges do we have?